It's more than eerie to realize the cobblestones under my feet were the very pathway a madman walked while carefully stalking his victims. And today, he still remains the most gruesome and elusive killer London ever knew. Let's follow the blood-curling trail of Jack the Ripper. Dark alleys and foggy cobblestones, world's most notorious and macabre serial killings. A mystery that today, 1888, marked an era of glamour and royal prosperity in England. In the city of London, the aristocrats celebrated. Queen Victoria had been reigning for 50 years. Only a few minutes away from this glittering display of prosperity lay a city of Victorian slums, where violence and poverty ruled, where prostitutes sold themselves for a penny or even a loaf of stale bread. It is here in the East End of London where the savage murder of Polly Nichols took place, the first in a series of brutal killings. 42 years old and mother of five children, Polly spent most of her waking hours drinking and roaming the streets. Without a husband, prostitution was a dreadful solution to poverty. Last seen leaving the frying pan, there, silent danger lurked in the shadows. By 3:40 that morning of August the 31st, she was dead. Her throat was slashed and she was disemboweled, the act of a psychopath. Not only was there no motive, but there was also no suspect. September the 8th marked the second bloody murder of a prostitute. The body of Annie Chapman was found in Chanbury Street. Again, the throat was slashed, and the rest of the body mangled with savage determination. A bewildered police force found no clues, and panic spread in the dingy, crowded streets of the East End. An angry public demanded action, and even Queen Victoria herself pressured the police for some sort of explanation. September the 30th marked a day of horror. The bloodthirsty killer struck twice on this fateful night. At 1 a.m., Liz Stride's body was found in Berners Street. Her throat was cut, but the rest of her body untouched. It led to the belief that the killer was almost caught and fled the scene of the crime. Jack's thirst for blood was obviously not satisfied that night. A second body was found a couple of blocks away. Catherine Eddowes was silently slaughtered by the fearsome and now clearly practiced hand. This time, the killer spared her none of his sadistic intentions. The next day, October the 1st, was the day the world would first hear the name Jack the Ripper. Several suspects were arrested. On the flimsiest evidence, they would be locked away in lunatic asylums, a pathetic attempt to rid the streets of the dark assailant. No one was above suspicion. The month of October passed quietly. People began to breathe easier. Had Jack the Ripper's crazed appetite for blood and gore finally been satisfied? Sadly, not. On November the 9th, Jack would strike for the fifth and final time. At 13 Miller's Court, the savage remains of Mary Jane Kelly were discovered, a young, pretty girl who was led astray by the East End life of alcohol and prostitution. This frenzied yet clinical assault was the most brutal of them all and shocked even the most hardened criminologist. Mary Kelly was skinned and slain behind closed doors. Little remained of her body. The police never found her heart. One thing was clear. While indulging in his sordid fantasies, the killer had an uncanny knowledge of dissecting the human anatomy. Jack the Ripper had an extensive medical background. After the fifth killing, Jack the Ripper silently crept back into the shadows from where he emerged. Numerous suspects came to light, ranging from the obvious to the ridiculous. Even rumors about Prince Albert Victor surfaced. His twilight trips to the East End, indulging in bizarre sexual pleasures, were notorious. The royal family panicked A cover-up was vital. Montague Druitt, a well-educated gentleman, but with a disturbing background, was used as a scapegoat to bury what could have been a sensational royal scandal. Druitt's knowledge of medical procedures and his suicide shortly after the last murder made him one of the prime suspects, and he still is today, along with two others. Aaron Kosminski, a man with an extreme hatred of women, especially prostitutes, made him a conspicuous suspect. But he was unable to make any sense in the police questioning, and he was put away in an asylum. Thomas Neil Cream, an American doctor, was hanged in 1892 for poisoning the Lambeth prostitutes. His departing words were, "I am Jack the..." as the rope snapped taut. Today, the saga continues to fascinate the world. In London, a tour is given following the bloody trail of Jack the Ripper. Samantha Holland, a guide, gave us a final description of Jack.
He was between 5'6" or 5'9" tall, that he had dark hair, and that he was generally well-spoken. That was basically what people thought of, and that he wore a long frock coat, a red kerchief around his neck, and either a deerstalker cap or some other form of a smart hat.
A diary signed "Yours Truly, Jack the Ripper" was found in recent years, and it describes in grisly detail the murders of the prostitutes and the writer's chilling thoughts during that period. The diary was traced back to James Maybrick, a cotton merchant. In 1889, he died of arsenic poisoning by his own wife. The diary is still subject to great controversy. Theories and arguments still rage to this day as to the true identity of Jack the Ripper. Even after the last murder, people were never sure if he would strike again. In his tortured state of mind, he wrote, "How can they catch me now? I love my work and want to start again. Good luck. Yours truly, Jack the Ripper."